nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Welcome back. I'm Professor Rickus. This is Biological Oscillations Part 2. In this lecture, we're going to take a look at circadian rhythms, which are inherent stable oscillations in biological systems that have a period of about a day. We're going to look specifically at the period timeless model, which was the first identified genetic clock and biochemical oscillator. And it really exemplifies the four design principles of biochemical oscillators, including feedback, sufficient delay, sufficient nonlinearity, and tuning or balance of relative rate parameters. So take a second just to think about your biological day-night clock. So why do you think that you sleep at night and are awake during the day? Do you think this is due to external or internal cues? Another way of thinking about this is, if we were to put you in a cave, what would happen if you couldn't see the sun? So would you continue your day-night cycle, typical day-night cycle, if you were in complete darkness? Could you track the number of days that you were in the cave by the number of times you fell asleep and woke up? In other words, one wake sleep equal one day or 24 hours. So what do you think would happen to you in a cave? Turns out such experiments have been done, and we and other organisms have internal clocks. So humans, without input or external cues, we're diurnal creatures. We're active at day. And if you put us in constant darkness, we maintain a clock, but with a little bit longer period. So we run about a 25-hour clock, most of us do. And we would wake up about 1 hour later each day then. And the constant light, conversely, shortens the period of our natural wake-sleep cycle. Rodents, conversely, which are nocturnal animals, they're active at night. And if you put them in constant darkness, the period of their day-wake sleep-wake cycle shortens. They have about a free-running clock of about 23-hour period. And they would wake up each day a little earlier, by about an hour. And constant light, conversely, lengthens the period of their sleep-wake cycle. And in fact, these circadian rhythms that are sort of sleep-wake is the most obvious one and the one you're most probably intimately familiar with. But circadian rhythms are everywhere. Actually, it's more rare for biological factors to not change throughout the day. Everything from temperature, cognition, learning and memory, motor performance, our perception. So not only the biochemical and biophysical things, but also our cognitive and behavioral outputs have circadian rhythms. All of these things cycle throughout the day. You may know this inherently. You may be a better morning test taker or a better evening test taker, depending on sort of how you, which category you fall into. So let's start to define what a circadian clock. If there's some inherent clock inside of us, what are the characteristics? If we're going to go look for that, what are we looking for? So a circadian clock is defined by having a period of about 24 hours or about a day. It needs to be able to be synchronized by the environment, right? You don't run on a free run. That would be pretty inconvenient if you ran on a free running clock and every day you went to woke up an hour later. That would probably not work out very well for your studies and work. So instead, we synchronize our day-wake cycles to the sun, to the day-night cycles, right? So we synchronize our clocks to the environment. Interestingly, the circadian clock needs to be temperature independent. So, which is sort of interesting, right? Because we think of most biochemical reactions being at the fundamental of how our cells and our tissues behave. But our clock functionally is actually independent of temperature. So we don't see the period shifting with temperature and such. And you can see, you can observe this in many organisms. And the clock must also be self-sustained, therefore inherent, not driven solely by external inputs. And so recall our stable limit cycles in previous lectures. So mathematically, if we were going to go look for a circadian clock inside of us or inside of ourselves, we would be mathematically looking for the presence of some stable limit cycles in those systems. So let's just remind ourselves of some clock definitions. Period has the usual definition, and here we're really looking at the time for the rhythm of our circadian rhythm to repeat. We can also think about phase shifts, either a phase advance or a phase delay, where the period of our oscillation stays the same, but external cues, for example, can shift the phase. Right, you know this when you you use the sun to sort of to shift and entrain your cycle to the sun's day and night cycle. So what is the basis of the clock? This was really a fundamental question about where does this clock exist and what's the cellular mechanism, right? So we talked about needing to have a self-sustained rhythm to contain this stable limit cycle. So we're looking for some sort of genetic, biochemical, or cellular oscillator with this inherent period. So if there's a cellular clock, this must be some inherent mechanism in the cells. Is it at the level of proteins? Is it the level of genes? And thinking about how the light-dark pattern would modulate the activity or wake-sleep cycle of us, how would this modulate the phase at a cellular biochemical level? It needs to set the clock in the period slightly. And so how does light modulate a biochemical or cellular clock? These are all questions that people began to seek out and still continue to try to fully understand. So some of the first experiments asking the questions of where does this exist does it exist at the level of genes, were done in Drosophila or fruit flies. And you may be familiar with them. They're a very convenient model system for doing genetics and creating mutations and then having the ability to do behavioral genetic screens of these different mutants. And so some of the first experiments screened for flies with altered circadian rhythms. So they had activity patterns that were, some were too short, some were too long, some were arrhythmic, no repeating pattern at all. And then they went in and can ask the question, what are the genes that were mutated that are underlining these different phenotypes? So this is a great time to stop and have a little history lesson, and it's often useful to think about those who came before us. And one I would like to point out is Seymour Benzer. He started his career at Purdue. He did his PhD in physics at Purdue in 1947, and he played an important role in the invention of the transistor and also played an important role in mapping phage genomes before the time of genomics or the molecular concept of genes. So as if that wasn't enough, he left Purdue and went on to Caltech as he became increasingly more interested in molecular biology. And he became very interested in genes and behavior. And he, you can credit him for many of these fly experiments that we just started talking about. So he did these highly original experiments at the time of mutating Drosophila and sorting for specific behavioral changes or deficits, and then searching for the underlying gene mutation. And through this work, he really became the father of neurobehavioral genetics and discovered some of the first genes underlying circadian rhythms that have really created the foundation for our mathematical and biological understanding of these biological oscillations. So one of the genes that he found was named period. So one of the genes involved, period was found to have point mutations in its gene, and these flies had a phenotype. Some had delayed, some had advanced, and some had arrhythmic patterns, and found that the period levels oscillate, so these are talking about the protein levels, oscillate in single cells with a period of 24 hours. Okay, so these were great clues that perhaps period is involved in or is somehow a part of the foundational clock inside cells. But this isn't enough to really prove that, just some intriguing evidence. And so the question is, are the oscillations inherent to the period gene and protein, or does another gene or protein interact to create the oscillations? So This is also a great topic where mathematical modeling and biochemistry have sort of gone back and forth over the years to develop this understanding. And so let's take a look at sort of a mechanistic view that we can build a mathematical approach upon and look about what they learned about the biochemistry of the period gene product. And so what they found, what happens with the period, so we'll start with step one here, and this little dashed box represents the nucleus of our cell. And so we, in the nucleus, we make the period mRNA. The mRNA, now remember we're talking about eukaryotic cells here, so the mRNA gets transported out into the cytosol, where it's translated to make our period protein. So one of the things at the biochemical level was found was that the protein period could be phosphorylated. And in fact, it could be phosphorylated more than once, twice in fact. So we have our unphosphorylated protein period that could get phosphorylated once and then twice. And that phosphorylated protein could travel into the nucleus and repress or inhibit its own expression in mRNA production. So we've got some negative feedback loop and some negative autoregulation going on in here. Okay, so we can now from this mechanistic view of the biochemistry build a mathematical model based on the biochemical, cellular, and gene data that they had at the time and ask the question, can period through this biochemistry support its own oscillations? And the modeling work, this was published, this particular model I'm showing you here comes from a publication by Goldbetter in 2002 in Nature. And the answer to this question was yes. And we can point out that this model has some key features that we would look for, common design principles of biological oscillators. We can see the negative feedback, right? We've got this negative autoregulation of the period protein coming back in and repressing its own expression. And we have some mechanisms for inserting delay into the system. We've got two steps here that can really insert delay. One is the phosphorylation, and particularly we have two phosphorylation steps. So those phosphorylations need to happen, and that phosphorylated period protein needs to be transported into the nucleus. And so transport in these phosphorylation steps can add time delays in that negative feedback system. And we also have some stoichiometry, right, from our multiple phosphorylation sites that increases the nonlinearity in our model. And so this model was found to, in fact, support 24-hour oscillations of period protein levels, but there was no mechanism for entrainment, right? We look at this biochemical mechanism. Where in the biochemistry can light insert its effects on the inherent rhythm? So the model was interesting and exciting, but perhaps incomplete. So what about other genes? Other genes that were formed or found in Benzer's lab included this gene timeless. So they found that timeless mutations resulted in phenotypes of flies that were arrhythmic. And so what was also found from the biochemistry was that timeless affected period. It affected period's location, it affected its level, it affected the protein oscillations, and it affected its phosphorylation state. So the question was, how did period and timeless interact, and how does light interact? So a new model was formed from the additional experimental and biochemistry information that was found. And so this was the, sort of then the new period timeless model. And one thing that was discovered was, aha, light can induce timeless degradation. So now we have a mechanism for light to interfere with the biochemistry and the dynamics of the gene expression in our system. It was also found that fully phosphorylated period and fully phosphorylated timeless form a complex that inhibit both expression of both proteins. So they found that timeless behaved very much like period in that its mRNA here comes out of the nucleus, is transcribed to make protein, and it too could be phosphorylated twice. And it was the phosphorylated form that was transported into the nucleus. And in fact, they found that timeless and period were not going into the nucleus individually. They were going into the nucleus together as a complex. And so now the question was, can this model simulate the experimental observations effects of light? So this is what sort of the mathematical model, if you just from first principles mass action kinetics write the rate laws for all of these biochemical steps that I just showed you in this mechanism here, then you get a mathematical model for the period timeless system that looks like this. Okay, so I'm just sort of showing you, and you can look up this reference again from Goldbetter's group in 1999 and look at, for these, this, but it's a large but tractable, ordinary set of ordinary differential equations. And we can simulate those. We need to do simulation. We can't solve them analytically because of their nonlinearities in there. And so if we, simulate these equations through numerical integration, then we can simulate the behavior of the biochemical system. And so what you're looking at here is the period and timeless mRNA and protein levels. Proteins are designated by, we've got PT and big T here are our protein levels. We've got these M sub P and M sub T, which are our mRNA levels. And we can watch then in our simulations, the protein oscillations, the mRNA oscillations, as well as the period timeless complex oscillations going in here. And it's important, it turns out, to look at both the mRNA and the protein levels. So what about light entrainment? Okay, so they found out that light affects the timeless degradation rate, right? So the effect of light, the outcome of what happens to the oscillations depends on, looking at our model, depends on the timeless mRNA level at the time of exposure. So let's think about this a little bit. So we know that light destroys our timeless protein. So if we destroy our protein when timeless mRNA is high, it delays the clock, a phase delay, because there's mRNA around to ready and quickly replace that destroyed protein, okay? However, if we expose the system to light when the timeless RNA is low, it advances the clock, a phase advance. And this is because if the mRNA is not around, is not ready to quickly replace the delayed timeless, we have to wait for more mRNA to accumulate before it can replace the protein. So the effect of light depends on where you are in the oscillation cycle, and particularly where you are in the oscillation of mRNA levels of the timeless and how quickly or how slowly it's going to take to replenish your protein from your mRNA reserves or lack of them. So some further reading, you know, if you're interested in some of the sort of the background and the history of some of this and learning some more about Seymour Benzer, there's a great book about some of this work called Time, Love, Memory that I recommend. And it's some interesting and fun further reading. And coming up in our next lectures, now we're going to begin to take all this information that we've been learning about design principles and dynamics, including the oscillations we talked about today, and translating these into device engineering. So we'll start to talk from a more engineering perspective about cells as actuators and cells as sensors, as well as how we might integrate cells into engineered devices that we're used to communicating with electrically and mechanically, for example. Hope to see you next time.